going to affect them, whether it's going to be shot calling or the early game, the late game, but playing with a different player always impacts your game in some way. However, in the past in this tournament, we've had a couple subs come in and perform better, or at least appear to perform better than their main roster counterparts. So there's a lot of questions with this sub, and you know, there's no reason not to just put pressure on him right off the bat, in my mind.
That said, we are into draft phase. It's going to be Cloud9 Tempest on your blue side, Frank Fang Gaming on the purple side, and already off the board, LeBlanc and Morgana banned away from Cloud9 Tempest, and Kalista banned by Frank Fang Gaming.
Kalista, no surprises there. Lodge showed yesterday how strong he can be on that champion, and when combined with something like Nautilus, he can just be absolutely brutal. We saw him toss Sheep in when Sheep had about 200 health, and they still managed to pick up just about every kill, and Sheep still managed to live. They prevented multiple ganks where Sheep would step forward to block a lot of CC and then would immediately get pulled out with that Fate's Call. So clearly, Laud and Sheep had the synergy there. And even with Sheep not around, it makes a lot of sense that they want to take this one away. Nidalee also being banned out on the side of Frank Fang Gaming. It looks like they don't want to give Hard the opportunity to take that one and would rather take it away from 14A as well than give him the opportunity to do so.
Yeah, really respecting that. Typically, at least globally in the professional scene, it's more about banning away the Rek'Sai and the Gragas. So very curious to see in the challenger scene that Nidalee is so alive and well, especially between these two teams. Urgot, the final ban for Cloud9 Tempest. We saw Alex Each go off, I think it was last week, on an Urgot mid pick. And I think everyone is now really respecting that champion's place. And I doubt we'll see Misfits get it, if not any other team, for the rest of the tournament. And there's the Gragas ban.
He went off with it last night as well and kind of shut Golden Glue down as we approach the late game. Of course, Gragas taken away as well means that Hard isn't going to be able to get either of those early game carry champions. Rek'Sai still on the table, though, so obviously he can still have a lot of impact in the early game if they want to go with that. Looks like they're going to stick with the Hecarim for solo on the top side, and if there's anyone on Cloud9 who can carry, regardless, it's going to be solo, and now that he finally has a carry champion at his disposal, it's going to be a rough game for Frank Fang.
Yeah, the earlier weeks was kind of playing outside of his champion pool with the Kennen, things like that, starting to get back into the groove on Rumble and Hecarim. I really like Hecarim as a priority first pick. I think he's definitely worth it if Gragas isn't available, just because obviously the Gragas displacement can really help counteract the Hecarim all-in engage. With Gragas off the board, we do see Rek'Sai kind of the number two go-to jungler being hovered over, as well as Sevir.
Well, it'll be interesting to see what they decide to pick next. Obviously, with LeBlanc and Morgana off, a lot more options open up. They're taking Sevir. That spell shield going to help her out a lot, especially now that Black Shield's not really an option. 14A on this Rek'Sai side. It should suit his early game jungle style. The real question is, what is Hard going to play here? And will we see a Sejuani coming out from him? Obviously, they have a lot of teamfight CC already with this Hecarim. May want to back it up with the Sejuani Glacial Prison. But picking an early game jungler against someone so aggressive like 14A, or sorry, a mid to late game jungler against someone aggressive like 14A could be dangerous. Both Hard and 14A have shown that they know exactly how to kind of counter Sejuani's weak early game.
And that's effectively what this comes down to. Sejuani, once she's post level 6, or at least even to level 3 and 4, she's able to gank freely. She's a lot safer in her own jungle, but that first initial clear is very dangerous for her. And Rek'Sai has such a fast clear speed that it's very easy for Rek'Sai to just kind of walk into the enemy jungle and heads up 7-up her. But on the other side, insta-locked, Rumble and Janna. So I really like taking away the Sevir from the Hecarim pick, because you're trying to play with the speed and outrun him and make sure that you have some sort of hard engage or at least a counter engage, then also pairing that with the Janna displacement of resetting the team fights. I really like what Frank Fang Gaming are putting together here as an answer for that Hecarim Sejuani hard engage.
And I just love the Rumble too as well. If they don't choose to Monsoon, they can always throw the Equalizer down in a team fight and kind of deny that hard engage and kind of turn it against the opposing side if they decide to group up. However, letting Lucian go through this far and prioritizing that Sivir is always a risky choice. Both Laud and Latman absolutely love this champion and have shown repeatedly that if they can get ahead in the early game, they can duel anybody, they can carry in any situation, and they can turn around teamfights in an instant just because of how good they are at positioning and how much damage they can dish out with an early game champion like Lucian.
And Lucian is also a really strong pick into Sivir just because her spell shield doesn't work as effectively against his culling, as it does, say, the collateral damage from Graves, able to absorb all of that damage. It's only going to take one tick of the culling before the rest of the damage is just going to eat away into Sphere's back. Last pickup will be Cho'Gath, very strong mid laner. I'm really glad that they actually took this away from Golden Glue, just because I think the Rek'Sai Cho'Gath bounce house double knockup displacement gank style in the mid lane is pretty insufferable.
bounce house double displacement knockup gank style. That is one of my favorite sentences I think I've ever heard.
There's no,
but it's accurate. I mean, we talked about it before, and we can talk about it again. It's just that Rek'Sai, it's so easy for him to get in and knock someone up, and then of course Cho'Gath has just perfect follow up between the silence and the rupture. It's absolutely impossible for most mid lane mages to deal with. You can't even flash out of it most of the time. So obviously great that they took that synergy away. And Cho'Gath in general, just such an oppressive mid laner. You can see Frank Fang Gaming did save their last pick for Golden Glue, wanting to give him that counter pick, something that Cloud9 does for Yasui most games. And it looks like Golden Glue going to opt to pick up the Vladimir here in the mid lane. And an interesting choice for him. Not something I think we've seen from him yet.
It's one of the few champions that can really stand toe-to-toe to Cho'Gath. You have to think Cho's really strong because of his built-in sustain, and then obviously his CC reach with his rupture across the lane. Vladimir's going to have that built-in troll pool, the W, so he's actually able to get out of the displacements and the knockups if he pools correctly. He's going to late scale into the game just like Cho'Gath will, maybe even a little bit harder depending on itemization and whichever one gets fed, so a safe pick.
Overall, obviously, a solid team built on both sides. Cloud9's with a lot more focus on teamfight CC. Every member except for Lodge going to have at least one way to lock down an opposing member on the opposite side. So a bit more of a wombo combo coming in from Cloud9 on the opposite side. A lot more mobility, a lot more counter engage, and some more flexibility for Frank Fang Gaming. It'll be interesting to see. I think I got to give this matchup in the mid lane to Cho'Gath. Despite Vladimir being able to match Cho'Gath's sustain, I feel like in the mid game, Cho'Gath just does so much more for a team. If he can land a single rupture, and with a Nautilus, with a Sejuani, and a Hecarim as well, it's going to be pretty easy for Yasui to follow that up. And true damage, just going to ignore any tanky stats that 14A gets, going to ignore any tanky stats that Vlad gets at any point during the game. So overall, I like the response with Vladimir, but I still got to give the edge to Yasui.
The one thing that I will say is I actually really like the synergy with Vladimir and Sevier. A big part of the problem as far as Vladimir comps in general is that he needs a flank if you don't have a hard engage to get into the side of the fight and make sure that he lands his ultimate effectively. You think you almost play him kind of how Evelyn needs to get in and do her ult. And with the Sevier speed up, the ultimate on the hunt, it allows Vladimir the mobility to position correctly for team fights. So expect to see how Latman and Golden Glue execute that.
Well, we'll have to see exactly how well this works out. Cloud9 coming in with a sub. A lot of questions for this lineup, but a strong hard engage comp against a Sivir and some disengage. We'll have to see which one of these teams can team fight more proficiently, because I believe this is the first time they've gone head-to-head and are fighting for that second-place spot. But with about 2 minutes left on the spectator delay, we will be back shortly. Tweet out your thoughts on the lineups, on the players, on your own lineup for Fantasy Draft with hashtag ADCL, and we'll see you in a few.
Welcome to AlphaDraft, where esports fans win cash and prizes for drafting top fantasy teams. Your mission is this: every week, draft your dream team from the LCS pros in that week's matchups. You'll receive a $50,000 salary cap to select your team. Teams have six players: a top, jungle, mid, ADC, support, and a flex position which can be filled by any player. You will also choose the team that you think will play best. Players are scored based on kills, deaths, assists, and CS, and teams win points for Dragon, Baron, and turret kills. Every week, choose from both free and paid contests that will give away thousands of dollars in cash and prizes. Once games start, watch directly from AlphaDraft and see your stats update live. Most contests have many winners, so check back often to see how you match up against other LCS fans. Good luck, and remember, knowledge is money. Be alpha.
All right, everybody, welcome back to the first game, the second day of the second week in the AlphaDraft Challenger League. My name is Daniel Sifadrakos. I'm joined by Ryan Frosker and more. It's going to be the matchup between Cloud9 Tempest and Frank Fang Gaming. Starting up for Cloud9, it's going to be Solo in the top lane on the Hecarim, hard, going hard, hopefully, on that Sejuani jungle. Yasui in the mid lane on that Vladimir, taking a little bit of harass here as he spams laugh. And then it's going to be Lod and the substitute, I Am Anjo, on the bottom side of the map with the Lucian Nautilus combo. Starting up for Frank Fang.
It's going to be Brandon for the win on the top lane with Rumble. 14A in the jungle with Rek'Sai. Golden Glue taking that Vladimir as he invades here with Baby Zeus on Janna. And Latman taking his Sevir.
Latman taking a lot of damage. Lod looking pretty confident in those trades, but Bonquish, Golden Glue on the way in. I can't decide if I want to call him Baby Zeus or Bonquish.
I know
he still likes to be called Baby Zeus. I know this name is mostly just to troll me, but it's a great name.
I always fumble the back part of it, so I'm like, Bon, Baby Zeus. It's Baby Zeus.
Vanquish. It's like Vanquish.
That said, we did get some deep wards across the map. Pretty much everyone just feeling out what side the jungler is going to start, if there's going to be any sort of camp advantage taken by the solo or duo lanes. Otherwise, pretty standard. Hecarim going to go ahead and take a camp to himself before he teleports to the top lane, so he will have that level 2.
Do have some good warding on the Krugs here, spotting out if Lucian and Nautilus decide to start with these Krugs for themselves. It looks like Bonquish and Latman might just try to contest this if they do start. Wants to see if they can get an EXP advantage. Rek'Sai, Rumble starting on the top side. Sejuani solo clearing the jungle. It looks like they do see Janicone in. They are going to back off, but they did get the smaller Krug. So still an XP advantage over to them. Meanwhile, in the mid lane, looks like Yasui just silencing a little bit, and so far an even lane.
A little bit of an issue that Latman wasn't able to get immediately into the lane and start to get his push. I think he did drag some of the minion aggro and get it focus fired. There he goes with the ricochet, making sure that they have the minion wave advantage, not necessarily the CS advantage, or excuse me, the experience advantage, see if they can compensate for the fact that they lost the mini Krug.
And of course, level 2 just so important in this lane. If Nautilus and Lucian get it first, they can just a humongous burst of damage in their favor. Sivir level 2 with the boomerang blade, similarly strong. We'll have to see if either side wants to capitalize on this. It doesn't look like they're going to. Lod and Anjo just going to back off here. Not wanting to contest the level 2. Just going to take it under the turret and farm safely. And of course, junglers just continuing their clear pass. Rek'Sai, though, going to be positioned on the bottom side of the map. It'll be interesting to see if he goes for a bot lane gank early on. He puts that pressure on to I Am Anjo as the substitute player. Or if he turns his attention mid lane to try to shut down this Cho'Gath.
Likewise, we do have hard very low. Again, talking about the frailness of Sejuani's early clear. Looks like he is going to end his at least first aspect of the clear on the side of the Scuttle Crab. Probably will back, grab his jungle item, and then head towards his red buff.
And it looks like 14A not going to have any vision of that back, so just going to continue his clear as normal. Not going to try to steal any buffs away, so both sides will most likely get that 2-buff start. Yasui slowly gaining confidence in this mid lane matchup. Has to be careful, though. 14A is on the way mid. But we'll get spotted out here by the ward. Yasui's going to move up to try to get out of the way. 14A throwing out the tunnel, but not going to get too much out of that one. I Am Anjo and Lod, though, in trouble. Anjo overstepping and getting caught out as the level 3 from Latman and Baby Zeus comes in.
And we talked about how it was really important for the Lucian Nautilus lane, or at least for Sivir and Janna, not to be caught off guard by an early level 2 from Lucian Nautilus. It's also just vitally as important for Sivir and Janna to constantly push in their lane. It's so much more potent that the Janna shield is used offensively, helping assist either Janna's attack or Sivir's attack with the bonus AD that comes with it, versus using it defensively to absorb maybe one of Lucian's piercing lights.
Yeah, you just completely waste the attack damage bonus if you use that in the defensive fashion. And of course, Laude will just be able to rip through that one pretty effortlessly. Of course, jungler still still continuing their clear, not too much impact in any of the lanes. Solo on the top side of the map, though, farming much more confidently than Brandon for the win. About a 10 CS lead in the favor, and of course, a slightly larger lead, but Solo having the advantage. This might clearly paying off for him as he pushes in this lane.
Definitely, that said, things will certainly get easier for Rumble as he gets more levels. He's an level-dependent champion versus Hecarim, who's an item-dependent champion. What I mean by that is that Rumble's going to get his power spike at level 4, 6, 11, respectively, just because of where he puts his points and his abilities, whereas Hecarim is really just item-dependent, making a lot of shops, getting a lot of his ingredients, and start piecing together that Trinity Force or Hex Drinker, depending on where he wants to go from here, and that's where he's going to find his power.
Of course, Hecarim, just such an impressive laner, especially with that smite, and especially if he itemizes the challenging smite early on, just going to mitigate a lot of Rumble's damage, even in those all-in circumstances. So it's really going to come down to Brandon for the win and his relative teamfight impact as we move forward in this game. Neither side, though, looking to do too much outside of laning phase. Looks like 14A may try to find something here on the bottom side of the map.
Laude and Anjo are blind. They're over forward. Here comes the tunnel.
14A not going to find any knockup on the Laude. Instead, going to go straight for Anjo. Anjo in trouble. It's going to be first blood onto the side of Frank Fang Gaming, and a large misstep coming in from the bot lane, and a quick focus down onto that sub paying off as he grabs himself a first blood and a kill for that Rek'Sai.
Bit of a fumble with the trinkets right there, typically. If you're being pushed in, you're just worried about that tribe because you don't want to make sure that the enemy jungler gets behind you. So what you do is you just put your AD carry trinket down. As soon as that one time's up, then you can put your support trinket down, but they place both trinkets in the lane because they want to control over the front brush, leaves them susceptible to 14A to walk into the back door.
Well, it worked out for them well so far. We'll have to see what they do exactly with this incredibly slight gold advantage. Of course, it mostly just mitigates the gold gained on the top side by Hecarim and that steadily increasing CS advantage. But the bot lane now remains even in CS. Sivir, however, getting that assist means she gets to back and buy the quick BF sword only 6 minutes into the game.
Thing to note is that the gold value, the first blood, did go back into the jungle, so it didn't stay in the lane, so it's not the end of the world for Anjo or Laude. That said, it's all about now, can 14A take this gold advantage that he was given and impact the rest of the map with it?
Of course, deciding to itemize that Chilling Smite and telegraphing like he may go for the Cinder Hulk, preferring those tanky stats, as he is one of the sole members on his team that can use those effectively. We'll have to see if he tries to force more ganks with the ability to slow down his opponents. Yasui in the mid lane, trading well with gold and glue. However, it remains about even, as neither one really has any kill pressure on the other, just not enough burst damage and too much sustain on each side.
The fact that Frank Fang Gaming are running a triple threat composition in terms of having Rumble, Vladimir, and Sivir, I actually really like the itemization of the more tanky Cinder Hulk versus a carry-oriented Rek'Sai, especially against a composition that has four melee champions on it, the only range being Laude's Lucian.
We'll have to see how that affects them. Cinder Hulk, of course, going to give a pretty substantial chunk of damage in this early game. And Latman doing a lot himself, as Law not even able to fire off the double tap passive, just getting that piercing light. And slowly the lane not working out so well for him. It looks like this substitute just not quite on the same level in mechanical play or in bot lane communication. So Cloud9 suffering at least a little bit right now. We'll have to see if they step it up as we move forward in this game.
Well, the most glaring and most obvious weakness so far is the vision, which obviously allowed 14A to walk in and to get that early gank on Anjo. Losing your support, especially one of as high a caliber as Sheep, is always going to hurt the team. So we'll see if this affects the team, especially transitioning to mid-game into controlling objectives like Dragon, if they don't have the same vision control and they're not able to rely on the same amount of picks that they would normally have available to them.
Looks like pretty standard play so far. 14A not looking for another gank quite yet, despite his advantage. Hard just playing patient, does have that level 6 now, as well as the Glacial Prison. So we may see him try to force a gank soon, but is a little bit behind as far as items just due to the kill given to 14A earlier on. Of course, Dragon has yet to be taken by either side. Yasui trading pretty well in this mid lane, actually, as he gets more and more levels into his abilities. And Golden Glue struggling to dodge these ruptures, maybe just not wanting to commit to using the Sanguine Pool just to dodge a single ability.
And neither mid laner actually having backed yet and spent their gold. Both just sitting on their Doran's Ring and Doran's Shield, respectfully. In fact, Yasui hasn't even used his pot.
Neither of them, it looks like. So now it just seems like a waiting game. Both teams want everyone on their team to have level 6. Cloud9 more than happy to wait for Anjo to catch up. Yasui could be in trouble here, though. 14A trying to find the way in. The Flash Feast! The Ignite gonna get him. Golden Glue not gonna get enough health back in time to survive, and Cho'Gath gonna grab a kill for himself. 14A backing off. And the patient play from Yasui gonna end up put him ahead in this mid lane.
One of the big issues of Vladimir, yes, he's going to scale fantastically into late game. He's really going to find his power spike at level 9 when he has all 5 points in his Q to reduce the cooldown on that spam and start whittling away opponents, is that he doesn't have a ton of kill pressure. So 14A ganking that lane is already incredibly terrifying, just because if it becomes a 2v2, especially against the Glacial Prism, but just the upfront burst true damage of Cho'Gath, it's kind of questionable in that decision right there. And unfortunately, Yasui's going to walk off with the lead.
And of course that lead transitioning straight into a Rod of Aegis, so going to be able to spam those abilities a little bit more easily. They're going to scale pretty well with that item as well. On the opposite side, Will of the Ancients, picked up by Golden Glue, so cooldown reduction very welcome, as well as some extra spell vamp. We'll have to see who will come out in the sustained battles, of course. It's still a very sustained focused matchup, although Yasui having a lot more damage at this stage. Vladimir still approaching level 9, as you mentioned. We'll have to see if that shifts the matchup whatsoever. Laud struggling to make an impact, surprisingly, on the bottom side of the map. It looks like Latman and Baby Zeus capitalizing on their overall experience advantage in competitive play. Solo could be in trouble, though. Has no mana. Hard on the way in. Brandon for the win. Going to throw down the Equalizer. Might not be enough, though. It looks like he will go down. A quick kill. Solo will get dropped as well. And it's a 14A versus Hard battle. Hard, of course, now finally with the items finished, as well as the red buff at his disposal. Doing pretty well as he takes this one down and going to grab himself a kill. A 2-for-1 exchange in the favor of Cloud9.
That said, both the kills went onto the jungle, so again, we have a situation where the gold hasn't been set up or hasn't been kept in the lane, so it's not like Rumble's really dreading his situation right there. He has a 20 CS discrepancy, though, and another wave was actually just shoved into his tower, so he lost even more on that exchange than he would have liked, but he's still not facing down a 2-kill Hecarim, so a bit of a sigh of relief and some breathing room from Frankfin Gaming. The thing that I actually wanted to touch on before that fight broke out on the top lane is Yasui's build path. So we've seen this from Yasui before. He likes to go the Rod of Ages, and what I bet he'll do, or at least what he's shown in the past, is he'll go for CDR boots. Now, typically other Cho'Gaths like to go for a Morellos because CDR is so important on Cho. You have to think his ultimate for having a true damage is about a 35 second cooldown. So CDR is very important in making sure that you can get out A, continuous CC, but B, even more true damage procs, as well as stacking your feast. Curious that he decided to go against the Morellos when its passive would work so well against Vlad's innate healing. But I like the fact that he's setting up his Cho'Gath for a late game, knowing that he's facing down another late game AP in Vladimir.
It's an interesting itemization choice overall, and it's clear that he's still doing pretty well in this mid lane as he builds himself up a small CS advantage. Now on the top side, of course, Rumble a little bit behind, but with the Haunting Guys and Sorcerer's Shoes finished, those are some pretty major power spikes for him with that early magic penetration, but it might not matter. Bot lane, Vanquish, gonna have to use that ultimate to safety, but Monsoon, not gonna be enough. As Hard gets engaged on 14A, could be in trouble. Golden Glue with the Ghost on the backside. Laud, no mana, the heal coming out as well.
Yasui's on the way.
Flash out. It looks like Yasui may finally be able to get there in time. The Glacial Prison hitting 3. Vanquish gonna drop. Yasui in the right place at the right time, finding himself a kill. Golden Glue and the rest of Frankfang Gaming overstaying their welcome. Still trading blows back and forth. We may see another engage with 14A here. He has the tunnel cooldown available using the Prey Seeker. Lodge so very low. 14A in trouble though. The Feast still available. Not used quite yet. They're trying to bait Golden Glue in. It looks like Yasui in trouble though. Gonna finally drop. Latman flashing in. Gonna get locked up under the tower though. Not auto attacking, so not gonna take the aggro as 14A. Gonna move in and give that kill over to Latman as he finally decides to auto attack once his team is there to back him up. Two for one exchange, it looks like, overall. No, sorry, 2-for-2. As Hecarim manages to snag himself a kill on the top side of the map.
And of course, Solo able to go hard in the paint right there, knowing that all of the resources were tied up in the bot lane. It looked really good initially for Cloud9 Tempest. Hard had a had an amazingly timed glacial prism. Of course, it allowed Yasui to follow up with a rupture to immediately delete Baby Zeus from the map. That said, Yasui got a little bit over-aggressive, overstayed his welcome, and was punished by the counter-engagement from Golden Glue and Latman.
And he just kind of held onto the feast there in that situation, really wanted to bait someone to dive him under tower, wanted to turn it around with that sudden spike of burst damage, just wasn't able to do so. The Prey Seeker combined with the Boomerang Blade and the Ricochet doing enough to take him out before he could really have an impact in that exchange. Of course, did get the kill onto Bonquish with the Feral Scream, but, you know, got a kill taken back on himself. So now Golden Glue pretty even in this mid lane. Of course, however, the cooldown boots finished up for Yasui, and he's going to be able to spam out those abilities a lot more frequently.
Still wondering where the Morello is going to sit in his build, if it's going to sit in it at all. Obviously would do wonders against Vladimir. Again, we talked about his sustain and how the passive will really help out there to narrow down that healing ability.
Well, it looks like we've kind of found a passive break after that last major team fight, despite now a slight gold lead for Cloud9 after managing to come out on top in that exchange. Just barely. We haven't really seen a dragon attempt quite yet. Solo, though, his farm is insane. A 50 CS lead over this Rumble, and Brandon for the win really struggling. His only advantage right now is just the sheer amount of damage that Equalizer can do to a whole team in a team fight. And it's very clear that he doesn't really stand a chance in this solo matchup. The challenging smite for Solo combined with those home guard boots just make him so difficult to push out of lane and so difficult to trade with. Anjo, though, trying to find an engage in the bottom side. Bonquish locked up, could be knocked out here. Law trying to find the kill, the on the hunt used, but it looks like Baby Zeus is going to drop. Anjo could be taken out on the bottom side. Latman going to get the kill onto Law here, using the shield pretty effectively. Anjo in trouble, trying to make his way out, but Solo could get locked down here. 14A trying to find the kill as they trade back and forth. Of course, just a few seconds till Solo has the challenging smite available. Will use it momentarily if he wants to trade effectively. Just going to run away on this one. And Dragon, in the meantime, going down to Hard and Yasui, as they rotate over to try to get Rek'Sai, the Rupture coming out, not going to hit. 14A going to make it to safety, and Cloud9 coming out of top once again. A good use of Teleport from Solo.
And what that came down to is so much pressure has been lost on the top side of the map for Frank Fang Gaming, just because Brandon for the win cannot compete with Solo. So if it comes down between a 2v2 of Hard and Solo versus 14A and Brandon for the win, Cloud9 and Tempest have the edge. That is why we've seen 14A kind of hovering around the bottom side of the map. But that said, it makes him very predictable to finding those counter ganks and to using that TP advantage like we saw Solo do right there.
Yasui and Hard kind of poking Golden Glow back and forth, just trying to catch him out as he moves between those two guys, taking a little bit of harass on them, both sides. Of course, Anjo moving into the mid lane is going to be able to clear out this ward with a pink there, trying to get some control over this area. Of course, with Dragon down, we may see another few minutes of passivity from both sides here. There's no real objective to take, but Yasui looks like he may want to flex his muscles a bit as he pushes down this mid lane. And the tower already at half health. Solo on the top side has taken one for himself, may continue to push in, and that Hecarim is a monster with the Phage now finished as well. They're going to have to send at least two members top to deal with him. We'll have to see if they do it or what exactly Frank Fang Gaming decides to do about the Hecarim in the top lane.
And then it's really about what is Cloud9 able to get when they have a resource mismatch on the rest of the map, if they can make the use of pressure points that Solo will create.
We'll have to see. Of course, the bot lane still over on the favor of Frank Gaming. Latman with the Infinity Edge already finished. Lucian struggling to finish his, will have the gold in his inventory already, but hasn't really had the opportunity to back and utilize it just yet. Of course, 147 CS to 159, so a small CS discrepancy and, of course, the extra kill in the favor of Latman, making up for that difference, but the finished Infinity Edge just so effective, and of course the piece is just not really going to have the same impact.
Bit of a lull in the game. Again, both these compositions are fine, trying to scale into late game. We did have Golden Glue go fairly hard on Yasui and drop his Vladimir ult right there. It will take Yasui low, but he is completely safe, not forced to burn his flash.
Golden Glue and 14A, though, going to use this advantage to get some deep wards on the enemy side, knowing that they have a man advantage now. And, of course, Golden Glue, the ult will be back up shortly. He's already itemized a decent amount of CDR with the Will of the Ancients, so we'll have to see what 14A decides to do here. The tower is incredibly low. 14A going to get locked down. That's not the target they want to hit with the hook, though. Looks like they won't pursue this one anymore, and the pings are coming out. Solo and Hard ready to go engage if they have to. 14A just going to back off. And it looks like they will be spotted out from the vision here. Hard going to clear out this ward, though. So they'll know that Sejuani's on the bottom side of the map. We'll have to see what they do with this information.
I don't think they can really do anything with it. Obviously, she's also clearing out a couple of the free wards. I mean, the only reason that 14A is here is, again, he can't go up to the top side of the map just because there's such a big discrepancy between Brand for the win and solo right now. And like I said before, it unfortunately makes 14A and Frank Fang gaming very predictable in where they want to play their pressure points. The advantage that they have going in is that they do have a late game scaling composition. Likewise, so do Cloud9 Tempest. So both teams are pretty okay to set a gentleman's agreement to just continue to passively farm these lanes and then wait for the next dragon as far as a stage or an objective to contest and fight over.
We'll have to see if that's exactly how this plays out. It does look like both sides are more than content to farm, clear out a little bit of vision here and there. But Latman, not 100% content with the gentleman's agreement, does want to get a turret back to even things out. At this stage, of course, not going to give them too much advantage. We'll have to see if Sivir then now transitions her focus into the mid lane to maybe try to take that one next. She is moving up the river and over to blue buff. Latman and Anjo, though, on the bottom side of the map, trying to get a turret back in response. And Baby Zeus, not quite to the bot lane yet.
We do have some important itemizations coming out across the board. Everyone's pretty much finished their big initial item. Both AD carries have that Infinity Edge. It looks like Laud is going for the Static Shiv, or at least a Phantom Dancer next.
Laud, of course, having a more recent back. Sivir with a lot of gold in their inventory, about 2k, though. Going to easily be able to go back and finish up some major items. So, overall, Lucian's still behind. And we'll see exactly what Sivir decides to get. She finally does go back here, and Hecarim, quickly approaching the Trinity Force, will have enough gold in his inventory to get that one shortly. Only about 300 away from the completed Zeal, and of course, 303 away from the completed Triforce. Dragon, though, respawning in about a minute. Scuttle Crab yet to be taken by either side. Looks like 14A going to try to get that one from the side of Frank Fang Gaming, but Solo still endlessly applying pressure on the top side of the map.
Has to be very careful about diving Brennan for the win at this point in the game, though, just because we are past that level 11 rumble, so he has the second tier ultimate available to him. So even as fed as Solo is, he does need to make sure that he balances the cooldowns correctly if he does look for a dive.
Let's see if they do that. Obviously, this next dragon fight, a pretty important part for both these teams, and I gotta say, it's going to be incredibly difficult for Fang Fang Gaming to contest this. Their options for stealing a dragon are incredibly limited, both because they have limited CC and because you have two smites and a Cho'gath ultimate on the side of Cloud9. So objective control should be relatively easy for this Cloud9 lineup, and we'll have to see if they flex their muscles a bit here. They are moving in to kind of try to clear out some of this ward coverage, but Solo not really headed down, not too worried about the teamfighting aspect just yet. Dragon going to spawn right about now, and Golden Glue going to walk down there immediately.
It's also a fairly unsafe place for Frank Fang Gaming to fight as far as their composition is laid out. You have to think, in such a small confined area like the Dragon Pit and the river in general, it doesn't give Sivir a ton of room to run and to utilize her ultimate, and it doesn't give many options for Golden Glue to find a successful flank on Vladimir. Who it does help out, though, is landing those sick wombo combo stacking AoE ultimates, the Rupture, the Glacial Prism, things like that.
Anjo going to find the hook onto Bonquish, the Monsoon coming out. They're not going to follow up on that one, but that will be their invitation now to move on to this dragon. They know the disengage option is gone outside of the On the Hunt from Frank Fang Gaming, so they will move in here. Obviously, Nautilus, Cho'gath, and Sejuani should be more than capable to take this for themselves. They are grouping, though. Could be vulnerable to the Vladimir Hemo Plague. We'll have to see if Golden Glue wants to go for it. Sivir and Janna on the top side of the team fight. They see Hecarim backing. They know the home guards are a potential option. Rumble continuing to farm on the top side. He does have Equalizer and Teleport if he wants to show up. Looks like they're just going to give this one up, though. So Sejuani smiting that one out in Cloud9 with the second Dragon buff.
And unfortunately, Frank Fang Gaming were unable to trade any sort of pressure anywhere on the map. They were thinking about maybe pressuring forward into that mid lane and taking a few more hits onto that tower. It is fairly low, but with fear of the flank, they didn't even want to risk the mobility of Sivir to whittle out of that one.
It's just crazy. You can see the vision control coming in from Frank Fang Gaming and just the sheer amount of wards they have around the pit. They were clearly prepared to fight for it, but it looks like once Baby Zeus blew that ultimate, once the Monsoon was no longer available for them, they just didn't want to risk it. They didn't want to risk letting themselves get hit by a single Glacial Prison and having that turn against them now that their sole disengage option had been used up. So maybe a good bit of patience from Fang Can Gaming, but they will lose the second Dragon buff regardless in Cloud9. It doesn't look like they want to give up their control of this area just yet, as Hard is going to clear out that vision for himself. Now Vladimir, though, on the bottom side, Golden Glue trying to get as much farm as possible. Could get caught out here, though, so Sejuani headed down.
Frank Fang Gaming are effectively waiting for itemizations and their power spikes. They need Vladimir to get more CS to ramp up to his core items completed, as well as Branded for the win to come back from the deficit that Solo placed on him, or at least get likewise his core, so the equalizer is just that much more potent against the team fight.
We'll have to see what Branded for the win wants to get here. Looks like we might see a Void Staff coming out. Of course, could turn into something out else, potentially an Abyssal Scepter. Maybe even a Rylai's. Spell Shield going to block that engage. And it looks like we will see the knock up onto Latman. The slow coming out. The Depth Charge coming out as well. But they are getting flanked. 14A and Golden Glue on the backside. TP going to come in onto that Rek'Sai tunnel. Really confused why Rek'Sai was going there. I forgot you could TP to the Rek'Sai tunnel. It looks like Brandon for the win wants to show up to this fight and make sure no one tries to go in onto his team.
Anjo recognizing that the Spell Shield was down, so using the Death Charge, but here comes the engage.
Gonna find the ult, the Wombo combo, and a huge turn. Cloud9 finding the engage. Onslaught of Shadows and Glacial Prison use. They're gonna get two instantly. The rest of the team gonna make it out of there, courtesy of that Monsoon from Baby Zeus. But an absolutely flawless use of the Wombo combo from Cloud9 means two free kills, and most likely this mid lane tower dropping as well.
Just so dangerous, the spacing between a Wombo combo, and it looks like Golden Glue may have stepped forward too far. Nope. His W, his pool, will save him from that one, but like you said, it surely will not save this tower. Unless they decide to hit 14A. So that's sending a message.
It looks like they are just going to have Cho'Gath split push on the bottom side, so they will still get a tower, but it will not be the mid lane tower. An interesting choice. Maybe they were hoping for the 2-for-1 special. Of course, those ultimates, just such an absolute threat. And this is part of the reason why I wanted to give the edge to Cloud9, is that it's just so much easier for them to run a Wombo combo team where all they have to do is stack CC. Whereas this Frank Fang Gaming lineup, while theoretically more powerful, much more difficult to execute. And you can see it already in this mid-game, as now Cloud9 has about a 4K gold advantage.
They don't have a lot of wiggle room with their execution. We talked about the flank that's really important for Vladimir to find to get his ultimate off successfully on as many targets as possible. Not a lot of chances that he's going to be able to walk up to the front of a team and just drop it on all five members. And unfortunately, he just doesn't have the space to really do that. But we do have the counter push on mid, and Frank Fang Gaming clean up that mid-tier tower and now looking top.
Looks like Solo could be in trouble. A lot of members descending down. Rek'Sai and Janna on the backside as well. They may try to force a kill here. Solo, though, still a force to be reckoned with. Will have Onslaught of Shadows available. They're not even going to stay to clear out that ward as they spot out Yasui coming in to back up his top laner. Of course, meanwhile, in the mid lane, Laud making sure to push in, provide some pressure elsewhere. And I gotta say, the warding coming in from Frank Fang Gaming is absolutely fantastic as they've pushed in deeper and deeper for this vision control now that they have that mid lane turret.
Golden Glue maybe in a little bit of trouble. Never mind. Again, the pool to his rescue. We talked about how since Sheep is missing, he's the primary starting support for Cloud9 Tempest. Of course, they're filling with their sub, I am Anjo. If their vision would suffer, looks to be a bit of the case, although Anjo doing his job right now, clearing out the river. Unfortunately, I don't think they realize how many deep wards Frank Fang Gaming have on their jungle.
Deep ward's not going to be too useful right at the moment, as the majority of Cloud9 pretty content to just push down this mid lane. Pure determined to provide some pressure here. Of course, Dragon spawning in another minute. This has in the past been a huge point of contention. We'll have to see if they're just going to give up the third Dragon buff over to Cloud9 and be a risky choice. Of course, they'd be happy to get the 6% AD and AP for themselves on the side of Frank Fang Gaming. And Spell Shield burn from Sivir. Doesn't look like they're going to be any follow-up, though, so they're not going to be able to punish that decision. So they now turn their attention toward Dragon, spawning in about a minute. Laud kind of hanging out like he's looking for a pick.
Typically mid laners who aren't assassins, they're upgrading their trinkets, the yellow trinket, into the, I like to call it the mini sight stone, the upgraded yellow, into the three sight wards that you're able to place over a cooldown. When you play your assassins, LeBlanc said, people like that, mid laners will continue to build the sweeping or oracle's trinket, because it allows them to stand in a bush to find the jump on someone and to make their assassination. It's just funny that even on Cho'Gath, he has that burst potential, but you see he's still itemizing and building him like that assassin or playing him for that style.
On the hunt, straight into the back line. Equalizer coming in as well. Of course, Golden Glue gonna get that clear onto I Am Anjo. They're clearing through hard as well. Solo coming in. He has the teleport, but not the home guards. And a quick two kills. They use the full power of that flank. And that's kind of what we were waiting for Frank Fan Gaming, as they snag the double there and now turn their attention toward Dragon. Should be an easy one for them to pick up, and they wanted the 6% AD and AP, and they're going to get it. A beautiful, beautiful use of the ultimates there is the Sanguine Pool, or sorry, the Hemo Plague combined with the Equalizer came through and just did so much damage.
That's what we were talking about, the On the Hunt providing Vladimir the movement speed available to find a correct flank, and it hinges straight into that Dragon. So fantastic play from Frank Fan Gaming to find a pretty massive power spike, taking that scaling AD AP buff onto pretty much two completed core items for every single member across the board.
Cloud9 moving like they may be interested in trying to sneak a Baron here. Of course, don't really have the vision necessary to do so. Preyseeker coming out, going to hit the Baron. Proc the aggro at least to get some damage onto Laud. Sui still taking pot shots there. The vision trying to get cleared out. They are going to start this one. Cloud9 feeling confident with that Cho'Gath Feast at their disposal. And Solo, just so powerful, feels comfortable kind of just trading blows here back and forth.
Yeah, gonna I think they're gonna back off this one. It's very hard to sneak a Baron against a Rek'Sai just due to the radar function within her kit. That said, you were correct that I think that they felt fairly confident with the fact that they had the Feast and the double smite available, but unfortunately, Solo is not tanky enough to hold off four members of Frank Fang Gaming. Doesn't have really any resistance items completed, has a lot of ingredients, however.
Of course, the big difference between each of these teams right now is the sheer power present in this Hecarim on the top side. You can see about a 2,000 gold lead. That one, pretty much entirely creditable to this Hecarim's farm, as the kills, towers, and dragons are approaching just about even, but 296 to 211 in that top lane. Hecarim continuing to scale up, and we talked about how important Solo can be on a hard carry. Sui, though, could be getting caught out here. 14-8 finding the way in, and they're going to get the engage with the On the Hunt. The Equalizer coming down across their own team. Brandon for the win, dropping the ball on that one, but they're still going to snag two kills. 14-A, 5-1-4 as he grabs those two. And it looks like now they're going to get a Baron for themselves as Frank Fang Gaming moving in onto this one. And even Solo, as fed as he is, can't trade with every member of the Frank Fang Gaming lineup.
There's so much hard engage on Cloud9 Tempest, but they have very little disengage. And so when people get out of position, like you see was there being over on the other side of the wall, it spells disaster for the ability to counter engage with that On the Hunt ultimate from Frank Fang Gaming. See if Hard can get the steal. He got it!
Hard going off here is going to give his life for that one, but gets his team the steal, and now Laud and Solo with Baron buff empowered minions are pushing down the mid lane. Frank Fang Gaming found a way back into the game, and Hard going hard took that one away from them in an instant as they break the inhibitor line and find themselves with an instantaneous 5,000 gold lead. Absolutely amazing smite. Laud could be in trouble, but at this point it doesn't even matter. He's already gained so much from a single smite.
Of course, tapping the Gromp right there so he can get the cooldown on his E to walk across that wall. That was a fantastic smite. And even better was the coordination from Cloud9 Tempest, not only to steal the Baron, knowing that that was their only play available to them, but to push mid simultaneously while it's happening to try to trade objectives.
They got the first tier turret and the second tier turret, and then of course, courtesy of the Baron that Hard managed to take, they were able to break the inhibitor line as well. And Lucian and Hecarim are both incredibly strong right now, and despite, honestly, Laud suffering early game, he's still going to be able to push towers, and of course, even easier now with the Baron buff. Frank Fang Gaming have to be frustrated with that one. They had the perfect Baron attempt, and at the end of the day, the 50-50 just did not go in their favor. I don't think they expected Hard to take that one.
To be fair to Frank Fang Gaming, a lot of professionals have said, at least the junglers have said, that the player who is looking for the steal has the element of surprise, so they say that it's not true a 50-50, it's more like a 60-40, but to the person who's coming over the backside of the wall. Don't know if that's just bruised egos talking, but it's well, okay, 14A.
Have you heard that from junglers known for missing smite? Well, regardless of the
It may have come out of St. Vicious's mouth, maybe.
Well, we'll have to...
That said, We never talk about how Lucian is a sieging ADC. I talk about this all the time, how when people think about Siege, they think about Jinx, they think about Caitlyn, AD carries like that, Tristana now with her new Satchel proc on her E and its ability to affect towers. But Lucian actually does fairly well burning down these towers by proccing his passive multiple times, and it's just like that quick 1-2 double tap. So they just get shredded.
Lightslinger, just such a powerful ability in general, and especially just with the Bloodthirster itemization from Laud right now, you can see him not so worried about the tanky stats on the opposite side, not worried about the Rek'Sai, instead just wanting to deal as much damage as possible. On the Hunt going to be used here, though. It looks like we will see in the engage. Brandon for the win with an Equalizer. Not going to hit too many, though. Solo on the backside. Going to try to find one. The Colon coming in. Solo running to safety. The Depth Charge is disengaged. Golden Glue across the whole team, though, landing the four-man Hemo Plague. Hard will most likely drop here. Everything turning against them. Law dishing out so much damage. Locked down and exhausted. Yasui trying to find the disengage. Brandon for the win. Flashing over the rupture. But just going to get eaten up by Yasui there. He is trying to turn this one around. It looks like 14A just out of range of the Feral Scream. But they will get aced. And a beautiful engage and a fantastic ultimate coming in from Golden Glue as Latman providing so much from the backside there.
What looked initially fairly good for Cloud9 Tempest, because it looked like Frank Fiend Gaming just weren't able to get in, that the tank line had moved forward, and it was just going to be Laud allowed to free hit, but he didn't do any damage. He really didn't make a dent on any sort of front line. We talked about how this is a triple carry threat. They don't necessarily have that big, beefy, tanky member outside 14A on his Rek'Sai, and eventually, on the very end of the On the Hunt, Golden Glue was able to just walk up to a four-man melee composition and drop his Hemo Plague.
Vladimir just absolutely destructive to those more tanky members, can just sustain through the majority of their damage. Of course, a little bit vulnerable to Yasui and that silence, and of course his functionally full EP itemization here, as we see Morel and Omicron, Deathcap, Boots of Lucidity, and Void Staff compared with that Rod of Ages. But still, the 10% or the 12%, sorry, coming in from Hemo Plague just makes everything that much more effective. And Brandon for the win, although consistently not really getting full impact out of these Equalizers, still able to dish out so much damage with the Flame Splitter and with those Electro Harpoons as well. And just the confidence to flash over the Rupture and go hard onto Yasui obviously didn't really pay off for him, as Yasui turned that one on him, but it kept Yasui in place long enough for his team to follow up with that kill.
And this is a big issue, is the fact that Cho'Gath doesn't have gap closures available to him. He relies on his Rupture to land. It does have a fairly long cooldown. We talked about when Yasui was going to have the Morellos itemized. He does have it now, so he does have significant CDR, but it's just so punishing, especially against the mobility and the safety that Severe is going to add and provide to her team. I do want to talk about how fantastic it was that Frank Fang Gaming, yeah, they lost the Baron. So it's kind of been like this football match back and forth. You know, they finally find a good flank. They transition to the Baron. Oh, no, the Baron's stolen. Okay, here's the big team fight on the mid and Hib. But they stalled out the game long enough. Oh, hold on, though.
You might find the Wombo combo. Onslaught of Shadows going to hit three. Golden Glue, of course, going to pull right under that one. The Depth Charge not going to land effectively. A questionable choice from I Am Anjo. And, of course, Cloud9 moving on to the backside. Brandon for the win. Isolated. Laud in trouble, though. Will get dropped down here. Golden Glue just does so much damage. Rumble will drop as well. Yasui, Hard, and Solo still alive and well. But overall, a two-for-one exchange as Laud loses his life there. And the remaining members going to back off here in this mid lane, and so much blown, and they managed to get something, but it still feels like the fight goes over in the favor of Frank Fang Gaming.
And this is what I'm going to talk about, is Frank Fang did a fantastic job slowing down the pace of the game for the substantial lead that Solo was able to get into the top lane and transition that into pressure for Yasui to get a lead in the mid lane. They stalled it out long enough where Golden Glue has his core itemization. We talk about power spikes. People hate this word now, the power spike word, because they feel it's just a crutch. But that's really just where the state of the game is as far as recognizing where your itemization and where you're going to be strong as a team within your composition. And it's waiting for Vladimir to hit these late game core items where he's just doing ridiculous amounts of damage. And they stalled it out and they got there. So now how are they going to deal with Golden Glue?
And it's just absolutely insane to watch Vladimir's damage go through the roof when he hits level 16, when he has that max rank Hemo Plague, and just combined, of course, with all these items, is just doing so much. Whereas earlier in the game, he felt like he wasn't making an impact, felt like he was just surviving, using that pool defensively over and over again, and now it feels like every time we see him fight, he flashes, he Hemo Plagues, he pools across the whole team. And I really gotta say, I Am Anjo showing up a lot for Cloud9, doing pretty well in a lot of these engages, but the decision to depth charge the Vladimir, a very questionable one, and not really a way they can afford to use this cooldown. They need to hit someone More reliable, but it's tough to hit Golden Glue and it's tough to hit Latman, so your options are pretty limited as far as the depth charge is concerned.
I was just going to point that out. I mean, if you're choosing between the pool and the spell shield, you're pretty much looking at Baby Zeus, which isn't a terrible target to lock up just because he's going to be their primary form of disengage. And we talk about how he's the main counter for the hard engage composition, especially because, again, all of them are melee. I cannot emphasize this enough. This is a composition issue that there are so many melee beefy targets on Cloud9 Tempest that it's very hard for them to get on top of someone if they don't initially get it with the Glacial Prism and the Rupture Wombo combo.
Yeah, a lot, of course. Even though he is ranged and is kind of the marksman role, he is still very limited in the fact that Lucian's range is one of the shortest in the game for marksman. And of course, just going to struggle against this Sivir pick as Latman has made it out of that early game stage where Lucian is just so much more powerful. And now, Sivir just able to provide that sustained damage as well as that overall teamfight utility.
Oh.
That really can't bring to the table. Latman, though, on the hunt, used solo on the way into the fight. Going to try to fight Golden Glue here, but not really in a good spot to do so. Golden Glue doing so much damage. Challenging Smite used here, but 14A is on the way. Laud on the backside, not doing much damage to 14A at all. Has not finished a Last Whisper. They are going to try to burn through Golden Glue here. The Glacial Prison going to hit one for the slow. Of course, trying to move in on a Golden Glue. Golden Glue going to get hit by the depth charge, but there's no one around to follow up. Brandon for the win. Focused out. Solo trying to get a kill onto 14A here. Chasing this one down. Finally shutting down the Rek'Sai. As he runs away, does have the charge available. May get slowed and locked up here. The Rylai's itemization finally paying off for Brandon for the win as he picks up that kill for himself. And still, looks like a one-for-one trade overall.
Yusui, full health, full mana, has all of his summoners and his ultimate available for how powerful this Cho'Gath is and how fundamental Yusui is to Cloud9 Tempest. Again, he just can't get into the teamfights with his Cho'Gath pick. The fact that it did happen in the jungle, kind of a misplaced teleport gone awry, he had to walk all the way around and try to get involved in the back half.
He may try to find the engage one more time. Anjo gonna miss the dredge line. Hard trying to move in here, getting burned down though. The Liandry's Torment itemization on Brandon for the win, doing so much damage to the limited magic resist on the side of Cloud9. Of course, seeing the rest of his team now pushing into the Baron area. Sivir does have On the Hunt available. This could turn against them. Anjo still fishing for the hook. They may try to find something here. The Rek'Sai is ulting in. On the Hunt is used. Anjo is caught out, knocked out as well. Latman now dominating. Yusui could be next as 14A moves in. They're trying to slow him down. Rupture used as Yusui flashes out, and Laud just doing absolutely no damage here. Hit up by that equalizer. Now slowed down. 14A on the hunt along with the rest of his team. They are going to back off on this one, but after those two kills, it'll be easy for them to transition this one to their first Baron of the game. But Hard still waiting off to the side. May try once again.
Round two, we'll see if they make the same mistake. We do see Baby Zeus warding fairly deep here to try to catch this one out. 14A not even on the pit itself as his team is still... Nope, there they go, transitioning off of it. Yeah, they learned their mistake.
Laud could be in trouble. He's going to use the Glacial Prism to try and disengage, but Hard will surely give his life for this one, which means the Baron is going to go in their favor, assuming they want to push for it. It looks like Frank Fan Gaming, though, maybe a little bit bloodthirsty here as they chase down this kill. They want Laud. 14A going to fire at the Prey Seeker. Going to hit him despite the flash, but now they're shifting their attention over to Dragon. Knowing it's an easier objective now that Nautilus has respawned and Cho'Gath will do so as well.
Yeah, they learned their lesson before. They didn't want to take the Baron. They instead wanted some bacon, making sure that Hard will not be up and available to contest for that.
Sejuani's bacon?
Yeah, it's a pig.
Oh, I forgot. Okay, never mind.
You're thinking like the human? Okay, that's a little dark.
All right. It's a little weird. Like the choice to chase down Laud instead of going for Baron, but we'll have to see how it works out for Frank Fang Gaming. Obviously, Rek'Sai gonna ult down the mid lane as they try to pressure this one down. The gold lead.
I think the issue was why they decided to chase down Laud is because they were unsure if Solo had the teleport available. So just because they killed Hard, if they didn't know for sure what the TP cooldown was, it could have been a situation where Hecarim could have done a drive-by. And he's level 18. Never mind, 14A is level 18. I thought at the time he was level 17. So I think that was their hesitation to continue to chase Laud and to transition into Dragon versus trying to look for the Baron afterwards.
Well, and of course, if Hecarim teleports in, he can just run in there, and the combination of Devastating Charge and the Smite will guaranteedly do more damage than just the Smite on the side of 14A. And like you said, that 60-40 advantage, so they never want to risk that one, and it makes sense. Patient play from Fang Fang Gaming. Yasui, though, could get locked down here. Depth Charge coming out onto Golden Glue, but no one there to follow up. He's going to hit the Glacial Prison onto the backside, landing it on three. But they're still going to lose Yasui, and that's a major part of their wave clear and hard engage gone. Solo finally with a Guardian Angel, but...
I feel like for the last 10 minutes, Yasui unfortunately just has been unable to do any damage, get involved in any of these team fights. He's either out of position and caught off and then just walked down, or unable to compete or get involved in the team fights at all.
Now it looks like Frank Van Gaming gonna break the inhibitor line. Law trying to do the same for Cloud9 on the bottom side, but Brandon for the win, chasing him down. They may try to push this one in. They have the minion waves necessary. Latman does so much damage in Golden Glue. Similarly, just going to easily rip through these lineups. The exhaust coming down onto him. He's just going to pull on out of that one. Solo getting dropped down by the Hemoplague Prox. It finally pops here. Manjo, of course, everyone just trying to fight to keep these turrets alive. But the Frank Fan Gaming lineup is just too strong. And they're going to break this Nexus and put themselves at 5-1. Cloud9 knocked down to 4-2. Frank Fan Gaming coming in huge as they completely outplay in the late game.